Hello and welcome to Middlesex Update. I'm your host, Melissa Hurley. Thank you for watching. Well, today we have a very exciting show. We have a local author with us. Dianna Dell comes from Malden, and she has quite an impressive resume, quite an impressive life, actually. She has been the Director of Public Relations in Saigon, where she hosted USO Showtime. So she has a little bit of radio experience. It's actually have a photo of her in her radio days. But today she's here to talk to us a little bit about her time spent with the USO in Vietnam and about her book, A Saigon Party. Dianna, I first want to thank you for coming on to Middlesex Update.
Thank you.
It's great to have you here. Now tell me a little bit about Saigon Party, first of all. This is a little bit different than other stories you'd read, other books you'd read about Vietnam. Whereas you really have some personal ties that brought you to Vietnam, and tell me about that.
Right. Well, in 1968, my brother Kenny died in Vietnam, in November 1968. And during the time he was in Vietnam, mm-hmm. and I have some pictures here of Kenny. Mm-hmm. Anyway, during the time he was in Vietnam, I was involved in the anti-war movement, the mm-hmm. Eugene McCarthy movement. And when he died, I just gave up on everything. And a year and a half later, I decided to go to Vietnam and see what the war was all about. So I was expecting to see what I had seen on television and read in the newspapers. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't like that at all. By the time I got there in 1970 with USO, mm-hmm. The war was winding down and troops were leaving. And it was a totally different ball game than it was when my brother was there. Anyway, so I decided to put this book together mm-hmm. just to show another side of the Vietnam War, because the books and the movies and everything you read see today it's all battle and angst and blood and gore and stuff. And I wanted to show another side of the Vietnam War.
So tell me a little bit about the book.
Well, it's pretty cynical. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty cynical about the whole war anyway. My brother died there, and I didn't believe that it was a just war. And when I was there, I didn't believe it was a just war. And now I don't believe it's mm-hmm. just war. So I turned my bitterness and my cynicism into comedy and satire. Mm-hmm. So it's made up of 21 short stories. The introduction, of course, tells why I went to Vietnam and what I did when I was in Vietnam, and then it stopped short. Mm-hmm. It's my first 6 days in Vietnam, and then I swing right into the short stories. And the short stories are about beggars and war profiteers, State Department people, fakes, phonies, crooks, saints, sinners. It covers this whole spectrum of people I met when I was in Vietnam.
Right.
Now, a lot of it's exaggeration.
Right.
And some of it is just flat truthful, you know. So it's a little bit of everything, and I'm getting good reviews.
Oh, good.
The right-wingers don't like it, though. You know, I have been criticized because some people are calling me too liberal for writing the book.
Well, everyone has the right to write a
yes.
book, and there's always free speech here in America. What exactly did you do for the USO in Vietnam?
Well, when I first went to Vietnam, I was in Cam Ranh Bay for 6 months. And Cam Ranh Bay is this rare echelon place. Mm-hmm. It's just a big base and full of sand and cockroaches and rats and stuff. And it's a support base. And what I did was I was a program director for USO. And that meant that I worked in the recreation center in Cam Ranh Bay, planning programs for mm-hmm. the GIs. We had a snack bar, and I mean, every single day there was a program, for cookouts and Valentine's Day parties and Christmas things, and just, it was open all the time, except after curfew. We had curfew in mm-hmm. Vietnam. And then, after 6 months, I was promoted to Director of Public Relations in Saigon, which was like, oh my God, it was going from this desolate place to this exciting city. It was a capital at war.
Right.
And my job consisted of, director of public relations job was, I had a radio show, mm-hmm. USO Showtime, a daily, mm-hmm. half an hour, 12:30, right after Paul Harvey. And I interviewed celebrities. I did record requests for GIs. We had contests and a pen pal program. I'd read letters from young women in the United States, like college students, and, mm-hmm. And then the guys would write in and ask for the addresses of these people and write mm-hmm. to them. And I brought some too. But anyway, and also my part of the job was flying all over Vietnam, taking USO shows, which I did have brought some flyers with me.
It's pretty interesting. Some names that I'm sure all you folks will recognize. Sammy Davis Jr. came one time.
Couple times,
okay. Martha Ray.
Oh, she's great.
Robert Horton, Jimmy Nichols, Renee Powell, Sandra Post. So, and these were all USO shows, and they were put on sometimes by the, in association with the Hollywood Overseas Committee.
Right.
This must have been really exciting, you know, meeting with these people who were celebrities in their own right at that time,
yes.
but have since still, you know, still have a legacy they carry today.
Right.
And also, it wasn't, I'm assuming, like a regular concert that you would go to, where these people were really taking the time out of their schedules to come to go overseas and really donate their time. And that must have been an incredible feeling, not only for you working with them, but also just to see the GIs and the looks on their faces when they got to see these concerts.
By 1970 to 72, the GIs were so bored because the fighting had basically stopped, our fighting.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, these guys were so bored that anything, every show that came through, a college group singing, the tennis stars and the football players and the baseball players would come in and just have handshaking tours and stuff. But I used to fly with them out to fire bases and these remote places all over the place. These guys were so excited to see these people, famous or not famous,
right.
you know? And because the Vietnam War was so unpopular back in the States, that major celebrities didn't want to have their name associated mm-hmm. with it. Now people say, you know, we should always support the warrior, not the war.
Mm-hmm.
But at that time, nobody was supporting the warrior, you know. So the people who came, really, some of them put their careers on the line by doing this.
Really?
Yeah, it was, you know, except for big names like Bob Hope and Sammy mm-hmm. Davis Jr., that they weren't hurt by it. But singers and dancers and stuff, I'm trying to think of, you're aware that Jane Fonda had the protests mm-hmm. and everything, she and Donald Sutherland. Nobody mentions Donald Sutherland, by the way. But anyway, Jane Fonda and Donald Sutherland were doing anti-Vietnam War shows around military bases all over the country and some overseas. And I would go to these fire bases and talk to lots and lots and lots of GIs, and they said, "Why didn't you bring her over here?" And I said, "Oh yeah, right. Yeah." The military is going to let Jane Fonda entertain the GIs in Vietnam. I don't think so, you know.
You talk a lot about what you did on a daily basis, whether it was a radio show or bringing in these top name acts to entertain. But what was done on a daily basis just to keep the morale up? You know, you've mentioned a few times that the morale was really, people were not upset, but they were just dreary. They were, you know, I think it would be hard to keep someone's spirits up. What was done? Was it the GIs talking amongst themselves? Was it letters from home?
Letters from home. Even for civilians like myself. I mean, I lived in Saigon, which was, I mean, I had a great job. I was never in any real danger, except mm-hmm. if a terrorist attacked a nightclub or something that
right.
I was in or
right.
something. But I mean, everybody's in danger all mm-hmm. the time, everywhere. But I felt safe. But the GIs. The GIs were entertained by, that's why USO was so important, but also the Red Cross had recreation centers, special services had recreation centers, and the one thing that the GIs just loved, the radio. The radio was the biggest thing. I mean, there was a television station, but I mean, very few GIs
mm-hmm.
had TVs.
Right.
I mean, it was, people in Saigon did. The radio was everything, and we had, you know, when you see Vietnam movies, you always hear the rock stuff, but we had, I played record requests, and most of the guys requested older songs, you know. The biggest song I think requested was "We've Got to Get Out of This Place" by the Animals. You know, I mean, I don't know, I never met one GI who wanted to be in Vietnam. They didn't want to be there either. They were drafted, they couldn't get out of it,
right.
you know, so they went. But the radio station in Vietnam also had Classical Hour,
yeah.
Soul, you name a type, country and western, mm-hmm. You know, every type of music, and the guys were like glued to the radio.
Really?
I mean, you know, and they would send in, my office, because of my radio show, got 600 letters a day record requests.
My goodness.
Yeah.
You've also spent some time as a photographer, and you brought along some photos.
Yes.
From your time spent overseas, and if you could, I'd like to just take us through some of these photos, because I think they're scenes that some people may not be used to seeing. I was looking at them earlier, and they really capture just the common folk, just the people you would see walking along the streets. They're not staged or posed or anything
right.
like that.
Right. Well, because
they're
of my
excellent.
Oh, thank you. Because of my job, I had a camera just attached to me all the time, you know, to take pictures of the celebrities mm-hmm. and stuff, for publicity reasons, for USOs, for
right.
fundraising
right.
reasons. But so I was always, you know, going everywhere, and I had to take pictures of the Vietnamese. I mean, when people think of the Vietnam War, they ask typical questions like, "Did you ever see somebody die?" You know, I said no. You know, I never saw anybody die, and I never knew of any battles that we were in while I was there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but Vietnam was a country, not just a war.
Right.
And people had regular jobs. I mean, Vietnamese weren't all carrying guns. So they worked at the airport.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they worked in restaurants.
Mm-hmm.
They collected junk.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there were homeless people. Oh, here's one of my macho military shots. Right, but they were schoolgirls, little babies who never wore any underpants, by the way.
Yeah.
Lots and lots of orphans.
Mm. Actually had a program with the soldiers, too.
Yeah, I did. I set up this a program called Feed the Children, and all over Vietnam. And I would take, or not myself, but all the other USO directors would take GIs to the orphanages distribute food and games,
mm-hmm.
and see how, oh God, the kids love these GIs, you
I
know,
can
and
imagine.
The GIs love them. The GIs love them. So lots of children.
They're great. They're great photos.
Oh, thank you. And like people on the street,
mm-hmm.
people going about their daily lives, little kids, or orphan pictures. Yeah, the orphanages. You know, that's one of the byproducts of boredom.
I was going to say, was there
huge?
There's a huge,
huge
amount of orphanages.
Unbelievable! It was everywhere you went, there was an orphanage, and it was so crowded, and sometimes these kids wouldn't eat unless we brought things.
Mm.
You know, we wanted to donate money to an orphanage, and somebody said, "No, don't give them money because it'll feed them just for a little while." So one of my very resourceful Red Cross friends went and found two cows. So
oh,
she
really?
Bought two cows for an orphanage.
Oh, wow.
So they'd have, you know, milk all the time. So anyway, but street scenes,
mm-hmm.
kids, Saigon Zoo,
mm-hmm.
and then of course the GIs. That's, I love the GIs. This the big sign was flashing the peace sign all the time. You know, of course the problem was with that sign. The peace sign is the same as the Churchillian victory sign, World War II. And every time a general would see a bunch of GIs, you know, the GIs would flash the peace sign and flash back the victory sign. The generals never could get it straight, which it was, you know. So anyway, just odd things, but...
No, these are great. These are great.
People on the streets.
So how long did you spend in Vietnam?
20 months. 20 months. I got there, I flew in with Typhoon Louise,
mm-hmm.
And I left, I came October 1970, and I left May of 1972, just when the Easter Offensive began. And the Easter Offensive was the last major offensive Americans were involved in any way.
Mm-hmm.
The Tet Offensive was 1968, which we won, but the amorally won, and it crippled the North Vietnamese economy and the Viet Cong because they lost so many men. So by May of 1972, we weren't expecting anything, and Americans weren't expecting anything, and the North Vietnamese and the VC just attacked like crazy, and we had to close. I mean, I was making frantic calls just about a week before I left Vietnam. We thought Saigon was going to be overrun, you know, and I left during the Easter Offensive. I was sort of happy to get out, you know. I didn't want to be overrun. I just didn't want to die in Vietnam. I couldn't do it to my family, for number one. But during the Easter Offensive, I had to make calls to a lot of the USO directors in Da Nang and Cameron Bay and say, just drop everything, get on the next flight. And I mean, these people, we weren't expecting anything. And they wanted to pack their suitcases and gather their things, and I was yelling and screaming, just leave right now. I mean, you know. So, and bases were falling and stuff, and then there was like a truce, and then Saigon fell, of course, in 1975. But
what is your most vivid memory
of Vietnam,
of your time over there?
Mm-hmm. This is going to sound weird, I know, but it really was a lot of fun. And I would never, I couldn't even express it the way I'd like to, but when I use the, but war is romantic, and you get sucked right into it. I went to be an observer, and I became a participant. I fell in love when I was over there with the Navy doctor. It was dangerous. I was in bases when they were attacked, and it was the adrenaline was pumped. It was exciting. I mean, I don't know. Maybe almost dying is an exciting thing, but not dying, you know.
Right.
I was in a plane crash and survived it. It was exciting. I know that sounds terrible, especially since my brother had died in Vietnam. Mm-hmm. But I know. I have been in touch with many guys who knew my brother in Vietnam over the years, and they say the same thing. You know, it was exciting. Mm-hmm. It was exciting. I'm not only killing people and stuff like that, but just the camaraderie.
Mm-hmm.
It's so intense. You'd meet somebody, and it was like instant friendship. You had to, because it was danger already.
You had a certain bond, too.
Oh, there was such a huge bond, you know. And I met people from... Oh, God, I mean, one of my stories is called, which the title is, The Saigon Party, but it explains just at a typical party at my place, my apartment, which as the director of public relations, I had to socialize with a lot of people for support for USO. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's how we got the money from people and supplies and stuff. But Quaker doctors and Korean generals and... You know, the four Adelines, a barbershop quartet from Wichita, Kansas, and Buddhist monks and Carmelite nuns, and, you know, all dancing together and stuff, pickpockets.
Once again, here on Middlesex Update, we're here with Dianna Dell, and Dianna has written this book, A Saigon Party, and she's also written another book called Memories Are Like Clouds. And Dianna, one thing, I think when people go through this type of experience, like you're talking about the Vietnam War, everyone comes back and they have to kind of adjust to life as normal when they get back to the States or whatever they do. But with the internet, it's really opened up a field of different possibilities. And you've been on the forefront with the internet business for years before anyone knew what an internet or an AOL or a .com was. How have you connected with maybe some soldiers that you worked with over at Vietnam, ones who worked with your brother? And tell me a little bit about your website that promotes both of these books.
Oh, thank you. I have a website called VietnamWar.net. Mm-hmm. And the reason I started it was because I just wanted to gather up all the information on the internet and then just, you know, put it in categories and stuff. And it's mostly a learning tool.
Mm-hmm.
And surprise, surprise, I have been in touch with a lot of guys who knew my brother. I emailed one person. My brother was a scout dog handler.
Mm-hmm.
So he was point man in every mission, with leading the platoons. Anyway, And I emailed the Scout Dog Handlers of America, and they made me an honorary member,
okay.
by the way, yeah, in memory of my brother and stuff. And when that happened, they mentioned me on their website and in their newsletter, and I got 6 calls from guys who knew my who were with my brother in Vietnam during
mm-hmm.
the time.
And, that's amazing.
Oh, it was wonderful. I mean, they were so nervous at first because they didn't want to talk about Vietnam. They didn't want to say it was exciting and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they were being so cautious. And I said to them, I was there with USO from mm-hmm. 70 to 72. And then then you understand.
Right.
So,
right.
I mean, there is this camaraderie, even though I wasn't a soldier and I was a civilian in a very cushy kind of situation mm-hmm. compared to those guys.
Oh, definitely.
You know.
So the website has all different links to
stories.
It's
historical. I'm linked up with colleges, mm-hmm. College courses, artists, books. I'm plugging my own books, but I'm plugging a lot of other books too, a lot of Vietnam vets.
Thank you, Dianna. Very appropriate to this segment. Right now we are going to roll to a tape of a music by Billy Joel, and it's put together by Bill Forty, who was a pioneer in local access stations. He actually was our producer, Joe Fortunato's mentor, and I don't know if some people might think that's a good thing and some people might think that's a bad thing, but he's definitely shown Joe the ways of the world of the local access. Joe, has he taught you about karaoke too, or did you learn that by yourself? You learned the karaoke by yourself? Okay. Can't talk about karaoke, you get too excited. So let's right now, let's go to the tape, and we'll see you back in a minute.
Thank you.
There you go. That was a video by Bill Forty. And once again, he's a pioneer in local access. We're sitting here with Dianna Dell, who lives in Malden. And she is the author of A Saigon Party and Memories Are Like Cloud. I have to say, on a personal note, I've read both of them, and they're very exciting, very interesting. And Dianna, tell me again about your website.
It's called VietnamWar.net, and it's an informational website about the Vietnam War.
But it's VietnamWar.net. Okay, VietnamWar.net.
By the way, I'd like to add something.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for also help editing Memories.
That was great. But I want to thank you for being on Middlesex Update, and hopefully we can have you back. We're lucky we caught her because you're going on a nationwide tour. About book signing tour.
In October.
Yeah, we're lucky to have you. Hopefully you can come back to the Malden area again soon.
Thank you.
Thank you. And once again, I'm Melissa Hurley. I'd like to thank my producer, Joe Fortunato. And for Middlesex Update, we will see you again soon. Good night.